that time already? Oh my gosh. Good morning. It's time for the show.
Oh.
You're watching The Dietitian on a Mission, and we're sitting here. We just woke up. I'm Janet Calderwood. I'm a registered dietitian. Allison Duffy, one of my best friends, she's also a registered dietitian. And, you know, first thing in the morning, aren't you ready to eat something?
Absolutely. It's been so long overnight.
So long. I mean, so many hours ago. And I think before we go eating breakfast, we should talk about how important it is for those watching us today to talk about the importance of breakfast and what we can help them achieve with that first important meal of the day, don't you?
Right. It's so important. What you put in your body first thing in the morning is what's going to fuel you for the first half of your day.
You know, I've been dreaming about this all night, about talking about breakfast on the show, and here we are talking about it.
What should we make? You have to start with your coffee.
Coffee is important. You know, actually, people have some strong feelings about caffeine, right?
They do.
But we do know, I mean, with caffeine, that there are some benefits.
Absolutely. And if you're going to do it, it's best to do it in the morning, whether it's coffee or tea, like my preferred beverage. It's best to do it in the morning because then when it comes time to go back to sleep, you don't want to have that caffeine running through your body.
Well, I will say this, that we know that even recently that there is some research that suggests that modest caffeine intake can help minimize your risk for Parkinson's disease and things like that. But again, the key is moderation with anything. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about, they say that 1 to 3 cups a day. And I would argue that, okay, when you talk about coffee, you have to be even a little bit clearer in what coffee is. It's all that added stuff is probably not what they're referring to, but modest amounts of caffeine, 2 to 3 cups a day would be adequate, and one cup has about 100 milligrams, depending on what you're drinking. So 1 to 3 cups is about 300 milligrams a day. The recommended upper tolerable limit, I think, or daily allowance is 400 milligrams. Mm-hmm. So, you know, sometimes people get caffeine in other substances, but certainly it can cause jittery and
everyone knows that feeling of when you've had too much caffeine.
And everybody knows when everyone around you has had too much caffeine. I'm like, how much caffeine did you have today? Oh, you know, 5 or 6 cups. I'm like, okay. So anyway, but I just wanted to say that because I know that it's certainly in this country that we have a lot of coffee drinkers and tea drinkers, and you know, maybe if you enjoy a cup of coffee or whatever, do so in moderation. Okay, so here's to you and you coffee drinkers out there everywhere. Cheers.
Cheers to coffee
now,
or tea.
And cheers to breakfast.
Cheers
so
to
we're
breakfast.
Talking about breakfast today. You said that it's the most important meal of the day. Why would you say that?
Well, I think first of all, it is breaking the fast of going 8 hours, 9 hours, 10 hours without any fuel in your body. So when you first wake up, you have nothing to really get you started. It's like starting a car without any gasoline in it.
It's like walking around like a zombie.
And some people do have issues with low blood sugar too. So you have to think about that and stay ahead of that before that actually happens.
So it's an important meal.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of things that people can do to help get their on the right foot, so to speak. Their start fresh and good. And we know that there's certainly a lot of health benefits from breakfast.
Absolutely. And it's also a good time to add in foods, healthy foods, to start your day. Breakfast is a great time to have fruit. And that gets at least one serving of fruit, you know, checked off.
Check it off the
for
list.
For the day.
Now, I know, not to change the subject or anything, but, you know, I did just wake up, and so I'm not really thinking all that clearly because I haven't really had any breakfast yet. So I'm working on the caffeine right now. But, you know, I'm sitting here thinking about cultures all over the world celebrate the morning meal with a lot of different variety, depending on where you're eating that first meal of the day. Tell me what you discovered when you uncovered all these cultural differences with breakfast, what people enjoy throughout
Well,
the world.
I have to say, this is something that people really enjoy talking about, which I loved. I love learning about different cultures and the things that they do, their customs, what they're used to. Most cultures, similar to us, start out with coffee or tea beverage, whether it's matcha tea in Japan or cafe con leche in Cuba. And so then you have varying degrees of caffeine in those too. So you have to watch with that. There's chai tea, there's green tea. Everyone has their what they're used to eating. Not a lot of cultures drink juice. That is something that seems to be inherently North American.
North American.
Canada, United States. And the history of juice is basically when there was an overabundance of the fruit. That they didn't know what to do with the fruit, so they would juice it. Apple juice started out as cider. Things like that. Very interesting things to find out. And then most cultures have some sort of carbohydrate. You've got the noodles, the breads, rice.
Who
is
eats
common.
Noodles for breakfast?
The Japanese do those things. Asian countries will do noodles. They'll do some dumplings, things like that.
So that's carbohydrate
that's
rich.
That's carbohydrate. Not a lot of potatoes. But some different places will do some potatoes, which we're used to.
Well, if they went to Skillet's, they'd change their mind because they have the best potatoes ever. Okay, so not a lot of people eating potatoes for breakfast.
No, a lot of homemade breads. Breads, some sweet, like what we would call pancakes, but obviously they're not the pancakes we think of. They're the hearty, rolled nuts, honey, dates. Those
rich,
kind of cakes.
Like sweet breads.
Sweet breads.
Okay.
Naan bread.
Naan bread,
In India, that's something that they do. Rice. Some have like the Chinese sweet rice balls. Or you have the more savory in Malaysia. They do white rice and coconut milk. With fish flakes.
Wow, that's better than Frosted Flakes.
You're right, it is.
You know, I mean, come on. That's a little healthier there. You're probably getting some omega-3 fatty acids in that. I mean, good brain fuel, right? And that's what you need first thing in the morning. We know that really when you look at a great deal of research and you review all of the literature, we know that functioning, I mean, if you're going to already experience a whole night without any fuel, like you said, and then you're going to plan on just leaving the house with nothing inside, that's going to affect your ability to think clearly.
If you have meetings, if you have school, if you have sporting events, you need to have not only your body ready to go, you have to have your brain ready to go.
Have your brain ready to go. And most importantly, for people that have a medical condition, like diabetes, for example, you know, it's your body actually turns the way that it converts or does metabolism after a certain amount of hours. And so you really want to keep your blood sugar maintained, right? You don't want to have any drops in your blood sugar, but the longer that you wait before you eat, you can experience that it's going to continue to go down. And for people that are older and for a lot of people that require medication and they're taking their morning medication, it usually is going to be better absorbed along with food. In many cases, it's insisted, especially if you have diabetes and things like that. If you're taking medication, you better be eating.
Medication on an empty stomach is, for the most part, now there are a few medications, obviously, that you'll be directed by your physician to take on an empty stomach, but for the most part, putting medications in an empty stomach can be similar to putting coffee on an empty stomach. You can really, it can really cause trouble in the mucosal lining of the stomach. So, you want to be careful with
that. So plan ahead, right? We want to plan ahead. And what about, you know, and we're going to talk a lot about a great deal of ideas and then maybe break down some of the specifics of the American diet and then what we can do better as individuals and making sure that we're eating a healthier meal in the first thing in the morning. But I wanted to get back a minute. We're talking about, the diabetes and everything. And then, isn't it true? True or false? This is a
It's
first.
really early
I
in the
know it's
morning to
really
do this.
okay. I know, but and I know that I'm taking into consideration that you haven't had anything yet,
Right.
so I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt here. But isn't it true that even with weight management, right, that breakfast can really sort of thwart off that hunger and help people from maybe going crazy later?
Right, making much better choices. It's been proven time and time again. Our Academy Journal just published another article about how people that typically skip breakfast, they usually do okay at lunchtime, but it's later in the day. It's dinner and beyond that they really overdo the caloric content of their meals. The people that eat breakfast tend to really pattern it out and have a more healthy pattern of calories through the day. Whereas if you skip breakfast, it's almost like you're storing
It's
up
like,
that hunger and then you munch and you keep going at
you
night.
can't stop it.
And it's the cravings, it's the,
Yeah, can't stop the train once it
once it's
starts.
going,
Okay, well,
right.
all right, so we know that it's important. There are so many aspects of it why it's important. When I traveled to Israel, I found that the breakfast over there in the Middle East is certainly much different than here. We had olives and cheese and breads and things like that. Of course, I was staying in one of the traditional kosher hotels. I think, no, we didn't have like, there wasn't, you couldn't get like meat for your omelet, right? Because then you already had dairy products, so you
Right.
can't
That
mix the meat. So they
translates
were
over to
really
kosher.
strict about that. But, and as I understand it, those parts of the world, that's kind of the typical thing, like cheese and olives and things like that that they eat for breakfast.
Right. We had from, I heard from Turkey, they do the same thing with olives and cheese, tomatoes, cucumber, and then they have what you introduced me to is the nuts and the honey and the sweeter type breads as
Blame
well.
it on me. Yeah, thanks.
Small pieces.
Small
And
pieces.
that's the other thing that was a common concept of, they didn't have the stack of eight pancakes. It was a little bit of this and a little bit of that, a little bit of yogurt with a little bit of honey, a good portion of fruit, typically. That was
Yeah.
a
That was a
very common theme.
staple. And of course, when you talk about fruit, I mean, fruit and juice in the same, it's really, they both count as a serving of fruit, but let's be honest. I mean, when you think about juice, you're not getting the fiber, you're not getting all
Nowhere
that
near.
roughage and,
And the filling,
yeah.
the full feeling. When you have juice, I always personally get the feeling of if I do drink juice, it doesn't affect my feeling of fullness at
It
all.
doesn't like do anything for you.
It's almost empty calories. I mean, obviously orange juice has a great deal of potassium and vitamin C, and there are
In Florida,
nutrients.
orange juice is the
Of
best, right?
course,
I
of
mean,
course.
because we're from Florida and we have some great citrus groves down
We
here.
do. And that was actually how orange juice started, was in Florida and California, they had the overabundance of oranges. So they started juicing them. And of course, it's tasty, but when it comes to orange juice,
It
you
can be
can
calorically dense.
very calorically dense.
A serving is a half a cup. Most people pour themselves a 12-ounce
At
glass,
least, at
and
least.
that's three times the serving. The American Academy of Pediatrics recommends that for children, because of the obesity epidemic and so forth, that parents limit their intake of their children's beverages to juice to only 1 4-ounce serving per day.
That
So if
makes
that's
sense.
going to be the morning beverage, then remember that that is a 4-ounce serving if it's juice. Otherwise, certainly introducing more fresh fruit into the morning. And that is very simple. It's like peeling an orange or peeling a banana. How hard can
Exactly.
it be?
Exactly. Or even having fruit ready to go. I'm sorry, berries.
Berries,
Yeah,
yeah,
it's
berries.
early.
It's early. I know. We're going to have to get some berries pretty soon,
Some
too.
strawberries, blueberries, blackberries,
The touch and go,
raspberries,
yeah,
grab
really
them and go.
easy.
You don't want to wash berries too too far in advance. Uh-huh. But if you do it the night before,
okay,
you can certainly do something like that.
Because you're very perishable.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, there's a high water concentration on them, and then they can grow mold and stuff. So
right.
you end up spending a lot of money on those types of things. You want to get the best quality. So
right.
you can do it just the night before. Okay.
Right.
So fruit is a big component of mm-hmm. breakfast. Mm-hmm. All right. And then when we look at our diet, we know that most individuals consume cereal.
Which is also pretty specific to North America, again.
Okay.
There were some countries that did like a muesli, the grains. I mean, I guess you could take the gallo pinto of Costa Rica, a very common thing, which is rice and beans.
Mm-hmm.
So you think of the same thing as the grains.
Uh-huh.
Okay, well, we have the grains in our cereal.
Okay.
But when... I hate to say it in such a definitive term, but not many other countries are pouring their cereal out of wax bags and boxes.
Okay.
Right. Of course, you can purchase them. Of course, they're everywhere. But most typical historical breakfasts from areas
mm-hmm.
are fresh. They're made from fresh items, whether it's the tomatoes, whether it's the... even the breads,
yeah.
they don't have the preservatives in them. So mm-hmm. they were baked the night before. They were baked the day before.
You're making me hungry.
I know.
Okay. Well, okay, as we're talking about cereal, so we have a real problem. Mm-hmm. And if you've ever been in the cereal row of the grocery store, right, that aisle number 7. No, I'm just kidding. I don't know
whatever aisle it is.
But, right. I mean, think there's... So many choices.
Way too many choices, I think.
They
put them at the proper height. So the sugary cereals are going to be where the kids are going to see them. The grape nuts are almost always up top.
Really?
You know,
they should be down there. Because,
right. The raisin brands, you know, some cereals that might be some better choices, the bran flakes, which... they can all have copious amounts of sugar in them because that's what we're used to tasting.
So if somebody was going to start their day like they have every other day for the last 55 years of their life with a cold cereal, would you have some specific recommendations in terms of fiber amounts and what types of foods, what type of items should be in that cereal serving?
Well, I think... I'm always of the mindset when I'm looking at a label, the more fiber, the better. I'm a very fiber...
Fiber-friendly girl.
I do like fiber, and it's also filling. So when you're talking about the brands, about the bran flakes, and you can put wheat bran on top of them. You mm-hmm. can do wheat bran on anything, really.
Okay.
They sell that in the cereal aisle as well.
All right.
Oats.
Uh-huh.
Whole grains is what you really want to be looking for.
And when we're talking about whole grains, we're really talking about the grains that have the three parts of that wheat kernel. So we're talking about the bran, we're talking about the endosperm, and we're talking about the germ. And all of those three parts, the germ and the bran, are the most valuable. Mm-hmm. Usually when you're talking about a refined grain, you're eliminating those two valuable portions of the kernel that add so much nutrient to to the entire whole grain, like the B vitamins, the healthy fatty omega-3s in there, and then you know, some of those minerals that you wouldn't get in the starchy outer layer. So anytime you can look for 100% whole grain cereals, you're going to be get your best bang for your buck. And you know, we know that certainly there are some that are naturally, like the oats. Mm-hmm. We're going to switch gears here and talk a little bit about oatmeal in a minute, but when it comes to the cereal aisle, you want to pay particular attention to that one added ingredient that they add to so many cereals, and that's sugar, mm-hmm. right? Because quite frankly, you know, the more sugar that is in the American diet, And I hate to say this because, you know, I'm not against sugar, but we know that there's a lot of empty calories that come along with that.
Right. And the more, you know, we're raised as children with our sugar heavy items. You know, you can take the exact same brand and loaf of bread from England and the United States, and one thing that you'll see almost all the time is that the sugar content of ours is higher. That's a taste that we
from
have
America.
Established from America. That's a taste that we've established. So from childhood, the first things we're eating and getting used to are that sweet,
real sweet,
that real sweeter flavor. So that's what we're used to wanting to eat.
And not just kids, by the way. Adults are doing it too.
Well, that's because you grow up eating like that.
Yeah,
so that's
Lucky
what you're
Charms
used to eating.
And those sugar.
Sugar smacks
or
and Fruit Loops and all of those kinds of things.
I mean, if you really look at the recommendations for the overall sugar intake for the day and how much you can find in some of those cereals, even things like Raisin Bran, which you would think, okay, the bran flakes are good, that's true, but the amount of sugar that they're putting on the raisins, so what could you do a little different?
You could compare brands. That's the number one thing to
compare the brands to the brand.
Right.
Okay.
The nutrition label's right on there. It's going to tell you. And some brands of bran cereal have less sugar in them. It depends on which, you know, if you're talking name brands.
Post or
Kellogg's or whatever.
The other thing they could do is they could certainly get a plain cereal of just bran flakes.
Exactly.
And add their own unsweet raisins or fruit or whatever you want to. That's one way to control it.
Right. If you don't have that separate cup of fruit, you can also add fruit to any of your cereals, any of your items.
That's a great point.
Yeah.
All right. So now let's talk about the oatmeal a minute because we're talking about whole grains. We know that oatmeal is a whole grain, the oats. And Allison has a spiffy idea for us how we can make oatmeal. You know, when people tell me, I don't have time for breakfast, I'm like, well, do you brush your teeth in the morning? Because if you have time to brush your teeth in the morning, I would argue you have time for breakfast, right?
I completely agree.
I mean, really?
There are healthy convenience products that you can get if you're really, really at the last minute that you have to pick something up. One of the really easy tips that I learned from a friend was doing the overnight oats.
Okay, tell me.
And you can use either steel-cut oats or rolled oats, which rolled oats are basically the steel-cut oats that they flatten, like on the road where they have those big rollers.
Yeah.
They flatten them so they cook faster.
And then the steel-cut oats are just, it's just...
Like the kernel.
They're the kernel, and then they're a little bit more chewier. Mm-hmm. So it's really up to, either way, whether you eat steel-cut oats or... The rolled oats, they're both very good for you. So
if
you enjoy one or the other.
And you can use either in this recipe. And basically what this recipe is, and these are typical little ball jars. You can get them in many different sizes. You get these jars. You can use any container for them, but I do like these. You can throw these wide mouth ones in the dishwasher.
Okay.
It's a cup of the oats. Could be either.
Raw.
You could mix them
you
raw.
Don't cook
just
them.
The dry oats. You don't
dry
cook them.
Oats.
A cup to a cup. So you use a cup of the oats to a cup of the liquid.
Okay.
Whether you want to use soy milk, coconut milk, almond milk, cow milk.
Can you use water?
I guess you could. But I think the milk gives it a little more thickness to it. But yeah, it's liquid. You just need to add the liquid to it. Or if you like it a little bit thicker, you can do a half cup of milk to a half cup of yogurt.
Okay.
So as long as you have the moisture in there.
So the ratio is 1:1, liquid to
You basically put it in your jar or your container, whatever container you're using, and put it in your refrigerator overnight. You want to make sure it's refrigerated because that's a bacterial boil.
Yeah, that's
if
the
you
danger
don't.
Zone.
That's the danger zone. You want to make sure it's in the refrigerator 1:1.
Okay.
Overnight, those oats soften. In the morning you have your oats, you can take obviously the metal lid off if you want to microwave them to get them warm.
Good.
Some people like them cold. Some people like to add nuts or berries or honey or whatever you like to add to your oats, you can add at that point in time.
Okay.
And it's a grab and go.
Grab and go. And you know, other things too, like, I mean, even something as simple as a string cheese and, you know, a banana. I mean, really? So when people tell me they don't have time for breakfast, I just like, well, then you just don't have any time.
Right.
Because if you don't have time
And if
for
you
breakfast.
think about even if you're eating in the car, a banana is a very easy thing to eat in the car.
Yeah, don't, don't try to
You don't want to be driving a stick shift
don't
with a banana and your cup of coffee
in the
or
car.
Your bowl
that
of cereal.
That doesn't really work
no,
too well.
Not so
yeah,
much.
Stick
you don't
shift.
Be scrambling
okay.
eggs in the car.
What about eggs? I mean, eggs, you know, we've heard all this talk about eggs. Oh, you can only have two.
It's been back and forth for years, hasn't it?
But it has changed.
It has changed.
And eggs are such a great, important component of the breakfast.
It can be, yes. It is, you know, you've got the proteins, omelets, which you can incorporate any kinds of vegetables into omelets.
And all kinds of eggs you can make. I mean, you can take the egg. That's a great source of protein. The highest biological value protein comes from the egg.
You can scramble them, you can poach them, you can hard boil them.
You're sounding like the Bubba Gump shrimp guy.
You got fried eggs, you got scrambled eggs.
Right.
You can make the omelets.
You can make the omelets. So there's so many things you can do. But I think a part that's really important about breakfast is protein. And so eggs are a great source of that. Nut butter, things like peanut butter on toast. Those don't take much time on a whole grain toast. Now, I do want to mention something about the Nutella. People sometimes use Nutella, which is that chocolate hazelnut spread. That's a lot of fat in there and a lot of sugar. I mean, you'd be better off just using a nut butter or something when you look at the amount of saturated fat. I appreciate for those folks that use it on whole grain bread. Thank you very much. But again, there are better choices that we can do with that.
Right. Nutella, by the way, is also very popular in Australia.
Okay. Well, there you go.
But now, there is a lot of sugar in it, and I would be very tempted to compare the Australian Nutella to the American Nutella.
Okay, now what about milks?
Oh, there are all different types of milks. Obviously, you want to go low fat. After age two, you want to go...
Nobody needs whole milk after age two.
So you want to go as low fat as possible. And there's rice milk, coconut milk, almond milk, soy milk. There are so many different types of milk if you don't want to do dairy. Lots of choices with that.
So we recognize that certainly milk is a great source of vitamin D and calcium, and all dairy is. So
yogurt.
Make sure that you're including that. And then how important is pasteurization? Believe it or not, we're running out of time. We're getting ready to go eat breakfast. But in a couple, give me a little brief thing about...
It's also very controversial because some people think that unpasteurized milk has more benefits to it. I think that's very, very dangerous because of the potential for bacterial contamination, especially when you're talking about older populations, younger populations,
the people immunocompromised.
That don't have that immune system that we've built up. So you do want to be very, very careful with that.
Okay. And, you know, and with that saying is, you know, certainly the best breakfast is the one that you'll eat. Find healthy foods that include as a part of your first meal of the day. Allison, we're getting ready to go out for breakfast now.
Yes.
And I want to thank you for tuning in. And I hope that you make better plans to have a better breakfast, a better start of your day.